Softer or Pamarasigan. And I'll have my friends flash. Ay, ako pala dapat, ano? Ayan. I'd like to introduce myself to you first, because many of you probably have no idea who is this woman in front of you. I'm a doctor of veterinary medicine. That makes me a doctor. Why did you laugh? I'm a doctor of doggies and horses. Oh, they're beautiful creations of God. I graduated in 1984 and I took my license after 2 years of working as a veterinarian. God called me into full-time Christian work with Campus Crusade for Christ. This is a full-time missionary work. This is an evangelical, interdenominational Christian movement. When I was assigned in Campus Crusade, they assigned me to the entertainment world of Manila. They challenged me, Orpa, try to discover how it is to reach out to the showbiz world, all right, Hollywood of Manila. And so thus started my venture of discovering this set of people, this beautiful, different cultured people. While I was in a ministry, we call it Artists in Touch. It's an Artists in Touch ministry. And when I was thrust into this world of the showbiz world, I had no clue about how to help these people. I'm a pastor's kid. So I lived in a sheltered life, if you may. I had no idea about abuse or abortion or whatever, all these great conflicts that people go through. And probably many of you come from those backgrounds too, so I did not have any idea. So while I was in this ministry, I had to study. I tried to study, I went into biblical counseling, I went into different modules of counseling just so that I could understand my own issues and help those other people with their own issues. Through the journey, as I worked with the artists, in 1998, I don't know if you, any one of you has seen this production. There was an all-Filipino production of The Lion, Witch, and Wardrobe. You know this book by C.S. Lewis, right? It's called The Lion, Witch, and Wardrobe, and it's an all-Filipino musical, and libretto was designed by Filipinos. Now, for this musical to be approved, they had to submit the materials to the Oxford C.S. Lewis Foundation. And the one who approves of this, all these productions, is the stepson of C.S. Lewis. His name is Douglas Gresham. So Douglas Gresham loved the musical. To surprise the cast, he came on the first day of the show, first night of the show. Douglas Gresham was the one who introduced Hope Alive to all the artists and the crew of Trumpets. The Trumpets is the theater company in Manila. So he was the one who was trained and discipled by my mentor, Dr. Philip Ney. And he studied under him, and he was promoting Hope Alive to these artists. There was going to be a training in Canada in 1999, and they said, some of you have to go. They all didn't want to go, so one of the artists, one of the actresses, called me and said, Orpa, how would you like to go to Canada? And at that time, I had no idea. I said, sure. So in February 99, I went to Canada to be trained with Dr. Philip Ney. This is, I get confused. This is the Douglas Gresham and his wife, Mary. And that's the son of, that's the son of Dr. Philip Ney. This is Dr. Philip Ney. He owns a mountain in Victoria, Canada, and that's where we train for Hope Alive. And that boy a while ago is this one now. he's a 14-year-old. His wife is famous in the French research. She was a part of the group. I forget the name of the Frenchman who designed the about mga Mongoloid, anong ang tawag doon? Down syndrome, sorry. Yeah. She was part of the team that discovered that. So she was quite famous in her own group of people. So I became a Hope Alive counselor in 99 and trained as a supervisor and trainer in 2000, and am a vice president now of Asia and the Pacific. I've had 22 Hope Alive therapy groups in our country and have had counseling, continuing education. I felt I needed to say this so that you will know that I have been quite trained and I have a passion to help people understand the dynamics of the post-abortion syndrome. And when I heard our sister here, she was just talking about the post-abortion syndrome on women. And now you will find out that the post-abortion syndrome does not only happen on women. There is a syndrome for the men, and there's a syndrome for the children who are chosen to live, whom we will call post-abortion survivors. All right? However, when we talk about abortion, you have notes, you don't have notes because you're adults, I figured, you know, some of you, but there will be notes there. Unfortunately, these are materials of Hope Alive, so if you want to buy materials there, you have an option. There's a CD there. You know, we've become very paperless now. So this is all the things that I'll be sharing here will be in this material that you can get from Cherry if you like. But you can just take down notes. Abortion does not come alone. In our studies, it always comes with abuse and neglect, right? And so the morning, in many of my seminars, I discuss first abuse and then neglect and then abortion. When a person is majorly neglected, the more he is prone to abuse. And the more abused and neglected they are, it's easier for them to go into abortion. So it's a cycle. It's a cycle of the epidemic. Cycle of abuse and neglect and abortion. Paikot-ikot lang yan, no, sa tao. I would like to just quickly tell you how are abuse and neglect related to abortion. A child whose body is not touched or stroked is less likely to like and be sensitive to herself. If the mind and body does not listen to its own sensations, it cannot know very easily when there is a pregnancy. A verbally abused person often dislikes herself. So how could she place a value in the baby growing inside her? The baby is too easily devalued and dehumanized. Oh, I'm sorry. Dito na lang ako titingin. All right. And then a sexually abused person tends to feel sex is dirty. And the product of sex, the baby, is also thought to be dirty. Kaya it's easier for them to have an abortion. And to a physically abused person, her body becomes the source of pain. So she tends to not to listen to it, and to do so only reminds her of the pain she felt as a child. So ayaw niya ng pain. Ayaw niya yung even the thought of it. Magla-labor pa siya. So hindi na. It's easier for her to abort. No? And I would like to refer you to many of the sources of what I will be talking. I will give due credit to my mentor, Dr. Philip Ney. And he has articles here in messengers2.com. Those are good. Many of his writings, and then anything about the training on Hope Alive you can look at in mountjoycollege.com. Alright, so let's look at the post-abortion syndrome. What I'll be sharing with you are just some of the core conflicts. Ano yung nangyayari sa utak ng babae? Ha, pagkatapos niya mag-abort, what happens to her? What are some of the conflicts in her brain? Or what are some of the dynamics in her body, in her system? How does she relate to other people? These are what I'm talking about. And one of the first difficulties that the person goes through is the issue of grief. For a person who has had abortion, napakahirap ng mag-grieve. Isn't it too often that you have people come to you and say, Orpa, I'm depressed. Yun lang sasabihin niya. That's all she will say. And then if you delve into it more and ask her, have you had an abortion? Not all of us ask that question. And I've always done that with many of the women who come to me, even men. There was a young man here in our country, young man of maybe 16, who was referred to my counseling. And he's very depressed. And he said that it's every July of the year he gets depressed. And so you ask, what happened in July of every year? And true enough, it's the time that his girlfriend had an abortion and he did not want the abortion. He's always depressed. It's not something that he fabricates, all right? He just feels it. So depression, the grief, ang depression kasi is grief na ungrieved. Kaya kayo nag-depress kasi hindi nyo nag-grieve yung grief. Did you understand that? So, especially for a lady, a woman or a man who has had abortion, grief is difficult because, number one, wala siyang, okay, what he's saying is, I know I must let go and mourn my dead child, but it is so painful I don't want to start. Grief is difficult because, one, there's no body to hold. Di ba sa Pilipinas, in any country now, part of the grieving process in any hospital is that, remember if you had miscarriage and it's dead? Di ba you're supposed to, the hospitals now allow you to hold the baby, right? So just so that there's a closure for in the part of the mother. In the war, the family has to see just even the dress, just to give them an inkling that that was really my son, right? That's part of the grieving. Paano kayo mag-grieve kung ang anak ninyo ay putol-putol? Charred to pieces. So the abortion is very difficult. Wala kang way to grieve. And then grieving is also difficult because part of you is saying, I contributed to the death of this child. Tapos hindi ka nagsasalita. You can't talk about it. You're not supposed to talk about it. Di ba after abortion, they will say, oy, bakit umiyak-iyak ka dyan? Di ba gusto mo yan? That's how the abortionists would say. I have had stories of women come to me and tell me what happens to them after the abortion is done. The doctor would coldly leave them or even look at them in a contemptuous way and say, go home. Tapos ka na. Right? So how are they able to grieve? They cannot. Kaya ang hirap. And then, socially, it's prohibited, like I said, it's prohibited for you to grieve. First of all, you cannot tell them you had an abortion. So paano ka mag-grieve? No? And then, you have to dehumanize the baby for you to be able to abort it. Ibig sabihin, bago mo ma-abort yan, you have to be convinced in your brain that it's blood, it's fetus, it's not a baby, for you to be able to let go of this child or abort this child. But part of grieving has to make you and I, or whoever, rehumanize the baby. Dapat maging tao siya ulit for us to properly grieve that child. Alright? And then, grieving is also difficult because of the ambivalence of the mother. Part of her wants to, buti na lang, nag-abort ako. Then part of her will be, what did I do? I killed a person. Sometimes they don't even say it's a person. So, naloloka-loka talaga. Makakaloka talaga ang abortion. And then there's no social support. Di ba pag kami miscarriage tayo, they will come alongside you, the whole family, the church will say, oy, we heard about the death of your baby, we're so sorry, we're praying for you, right? abortion, you don't even talk about it. If you grieve, oh, eh, anong tinaiiyak-iyak mo dyan? So, talo talaga. Talo yung girl. And even the man, no? No, then, there is no professional help. After the abortion, nobody, not a lot of people are trained to help the post-abortive person. Well, now more than anything, that's why I want to have a lot of trainings for post-abortion. So we have to be more equipped. And then grieving, there's no explanation given to a person who has aborted na, oh, pagka nag-abort ka, itong mangyayari sa'yo, ha? Pwede kang magka-cancer, ha? Pagka nag-abort ka, magiging napakagalitin mo, ha? Hindi ka na magbabahan sa anak mo, hindi ka na magbabahan sa asawa mo. These are some of the things they never tell us. Never tell you. By the way, part of informed consent should be, which they never do in America or other in Europe, is that they never present the silent scream before you. Diba in America, when you're pregnant, tama po ba? The first question they have to ask you is, do you want to keep the baby? By law, the people who come, if you come to the triage in the hospital, the person have to ask you, do you want to keep the baby? Unang tanong yun. Oh. Because nga po is legal. That's part of the, ano. They have tight defenses. There's no time to grieve. Okay, that's just part of the grieving. Then the second syndrome is guilt. Napaka-huge ng amount of guilt. Basically because of that part where they feel they are part of the death of this person. Deep in my heart, I know I've done something very destructive. But if I acknowledge the extent of my aggression or ignorance, I won't be able to live with myself. And then there's fear. Alam niyo ba na ang halos lahat na nag-post-abort, they are afraid that what they did to their baby will be done to them. That's why napakapraning niya mga yan, no? They're afraid, they become very violent. You know why? Because God has designed for the mother and the father, di ba? Parents, to protect their young. Even in the animal kingdom, kitang-kita niyo po yun, di ba? Kapag when a goat or a dog, right, gives birth to a child, the mom protects it. You see these things in YouTube where the little tiny kitten was held by the mother. That's God's design. So when you do an abortion, you cross that line, right? And you've crossed the line of protection. Na wala ka ng feel mo, you can kill anybody. Kung mapapatay mo to, you can kill everybody. So natatakot sila for what else they can do to themselves, to other people, or maybe what's being done to them, to the child, will be done to her. Alright? And then, there's wantedness. I couldn't welcome my baby because I was afraid and or selfish. So I told myself that if I didn't want him, it was alright to get rid of him. Alam niyo ba, meron akong kaibigan. I love this woman. She has had 8 abortions. And she is part of Hope Alive, Manila. Alam niyo ba na because before she became a Christian, kung ano-anong religion ang pinasukan niya. Ito sa Hare Krishna, di ba, sa Hinduism, or I don't know, New Age. Di ba ang belief nila, pagka namatay ka, you become another better person. Kaya daw niya ina-abort ang mga anak niya. Dahil she wants them to have a better life. You see how evil and distorted that is. So, let's go into the extreme naman. Then there's this huge, amazing concept of anger. Alam niyo po ang mga post-abortive women and the men, I'll tell you later, these are the people who are rageful. They fly into rage. My friend, the one I was telling you who has had 8 abortions, would tell me the story that before she has found healing and her children would be falling on the stairs and she would kick on them and she would say, die, die. And she would say to me, Orpa, I don't know where this rage is coming from. Kakalungkot, ano po? And they don't even know that. They don't know where this rage is stirred. Anything triggers their rage. The sight of another child triggers their rage. They're angry at the person who impregnated them. They're angry at themselves. They're angry at God. So lahat ng dadaan sa daan niya, galit siya. Ay, buti na lang wala ka ako sa tabi noon. Alright, here's an interesting phenomenon. Truncation of a hormonal cycle. When you say truncation, it's like stopping, no? Pinutol. Oo, pinutol or in-stop. Tinigil ang isang hormonal cycle. I can't really describe it, but I feel off balance. Something like jet lag, only much worse. Maybe I need more sleep. Now, this is a physiological thing. You know that pregnancy, like any biorhythm, like sleep is a biorhythm. Alam niyo yung biorhythm, di ba? Pag may simula, dapat matapos. Menstruation is a biorhythm. Pag may simula, dapat matapos. Sleep is a biorhythm. When you start to sleep, you have to wake up properly. You wake up that little boy. Hindi nagalit sa iyan. In the same way, pregnancy is a biorhythm. When you're pregnant, you all know that our body is highly dividing and highly differentiating ang cells natin. Especially in the genital organs like the mammary glands and reproductive system. They are highly dividing cells. Ngayon, itigil nyo yon on the second month. E nagdi-divide yung mga cells. Natigil. Parang nakaganon yung mga cells. Na-shock. Na hindi na alam kung saan pupunta. If you look at this in the microscope, these are highly differentiated cells, which the doctors will know that these are cancer cells. And that's why, but the Americans, of course, will never agree to this, that there's a direct connection, link to the breast cancers or other reproductive cancers. There are still a lot of studies that are being done. Kasi we cannot just tell them, oh, there's a link. You have to have evidence. Right? You have to have statistics. You have to have evidence. So, we should be part of that. All right. The self-worth is very poor. I never did feel very good about myself. Now I feel I'm absolutely no good for anything. And then, retaliation. She feels, why is it only me that has to suffer? Di ba meron akong lover na iniwan ako? Bakit ako lang? My boyfriend got off scot-free and now he is dating someone else. Alright? This is interesting. It has been 6 months since my abortion and I feel worse than ever. Suddenly, I can remember every detail of my abortion 1 year ago. Now, this is so interesting to me because I've had a lot of women come to counseling and sometimes they will only ask about some pains. Like this boy that I told you. These are anniversary reactions. Yung depression niya every July. Now there's a lady, when I sat in the group of Dr. Ney in Canada, I sat in two of his actual groups. And this lady always had pain every time, about September. Pain, and these are pain from her waist down. And it really causes her to be, nakalatay lang, bedridden. No? And she would come to the counseling, and of course we would discuss this. Physiologically, how we would describe it is, I don't know where I put it, but there's what you call vicarious pain in abortion. Ibig sabihin noon, nakakaramdam yung mother ng mga sakit-sakit. Minsan may dadating sa inyo ang sasakit ng mga joints, masasakit lahat. If they have all their checkups, everything is perfect. But they feel this pain here, this pain there, they don't know. Ask if they've had an abortion. And usually it's during the month that they've had an abortion, or actually the day, no? Sila lang nakakaalam niyan. Then there's a sense of incompleteness. I feel something is missing even though I'm sure I did the right thing. This is why, this one, this feeling of incompleteness. Remember, they removed the baby. Something in their system gives them a sense of hollowness. And this is why the that woman wants to be pregnant again. That's why do not be surprised after one abortion, this woman may have another, two or third abortion. This is an interesting syndrome because they become very promiscuous more as a result of wanting to be pregnant again and abort again. The fear of being a parent, I won't discuss that, alam niyo na yan. And then the distrust. I want to be loved and supported more than ever. I do not like being alone, but who can I trust? Now, this is so interesting because many of the women, wala na silang itatrust. How can I trust you? You represent the man who left me. How can I trust you? You represent the doctor who gave my abortion. Wala na silang itatrust. They're very distrusting, even to a friend. No? And the loss of the person one should have become. What should she have become? She should have been a mother of three. Eh, wala siyang anak ngayon. Dahil inabort niya yung tatlo. She should have been a wife of a man who loved her and has children. Wala na. It's a loss, isn't it? It's a major grief. Memories, I've forgotten so many things about my life I don't want to remember because I'm afraid something terrible may have happened to me. Yeah, disrupted sleep. Many of the women who come to me have lots of nightmares, and usually the nightmares are violent. Either somebody's out to with a knife, something with blood, yung mga nightmares nila, ganyan ang mga kinakwento nila, or running away from something, or running away to something. No, these are the kinds of sleep. Unresolved crisis of incorporation, this is stretching me beyond my limits. It's too much. I can't change for this. Fractured feminine or masculine identity. This is one of the interesting dynamics where the men, the women, actually become gay. For the women, of course, they distrust the man na nga, so they would rather trust the woman. For the gay men, later on you will see that they feel very impotent. Because they were stripped of their masculine design to protect the mother and the daughter or whoever. So, hindi ka magugulat na maraming gay ngayon. Diba? In fact, gay, of course, the gay people don't reproduce, they recruit. They always have dogs. Paano yung malalaman na gay yun? May doggy. No, but you know, this is an interesting phenomenon. I want Dr. Ney and I are trying to have a research, because many times the gay couples, they have dogs, diba? They treat them. That's why it's a boom. They have PetSmart that are huge, like, right, sir? They have PetSmart that are huge, like one mall. And they, you know, yung mga dinadala ngayon na kaya marami ng mga damit-damit ng aso, because they try to treat them as their babies. And I wouldn't be surprised if these people have had abortions. They would rather keep a dog than be pregnant again. Interesting, ano? Alright, parenting problem. I sense the abortion did something damaging to my ability to relate to children. Okay, reenactment of tragedy. I still can't figure why I did it. Sure, there were lots of reasons why abortion seemed best, but they don't seem very important now. Maybe the only way to really understand what was going on in my head is to get pregnant again. It is nasabi ko sa inyo, no? They need to understand what happened to them, kaya kailangan maging pregnant sila ulit. Psychosomatic illness. It is sinasabi ko sa inyo. These are not fabricated illnesses, huh? These are not, they didn't plan on having illnesses. They actually feel this. They're actually sick. Right? So the body will, the body is designed by God. I'm sure it's God's way of exposing something. But this one I was talking to you about, the vicarious experience pain in abortion. The unborn baby's terrifying trauma may be vicariously experienced by the mother via a combination of psychological and neurochemical mechanisms. Hormones associated with infant stress and pain probably cross the placental barrier in sufficient amounts to be perceived and experienced by the mother. Sensations from the uterus during abortion also may evoke images in the mother's mind and mechanism. Isn't that amazing? Kaya hindi ako nagugulat kung yung mga post-abortion woman, merong mga sakit-sakit talaga. Masasakit. You know, this friend of mine who has had abortion of 8 children, she really says that it's like knives sticking in all her joints. And I couldn't, of course I couldn't understand that. But she was describing this. Lily, did I tell you about it? Hindi, no? But yun, sakit na yun, I don't understand that. But that's how she described it. The pain is not like, probably will, hopefully will never understand. Oh, this is the continuation. Sensations from the uterus during abortion also may evoke images in the mother's mind. Like all mothers, the woman undergoing an abortion automatically emphasizes with her infant's distress, especially if she had a painful infancy. Though this vicarious experience of trauma may be repressed, it makes an indelible imprint which may later affect the woman's health. All right, enough said about that. Then there's depression. You know that already. Poor physical health. All right, if a person is poor, is depressed, hindi yan kakain. Di ba? Hindi magliligo. So bababa ang immune system. They become very sick. They want to die. So, it's a cycle, no? Lahat ng physiology nila, lahat affected. That is why, ladies and gentlemen, one of the questions I heard a while ago from a sister here is when a person is trying to debate in her mind kung mag-abort siya or hindi. Actually, we should be in a position to be asking them. Alibawa, may discussion, ano? They will say whether is abortion right or wrong. You've got to ask one question. If you can tell me if there's any benefit of abortion, give me a list of physiologic benefits, physical, emotional benefits. Give me a list right now of what the benefits are. And these guys know they don't have any document. We, or you and I, have a document, have documents to prove that abortion are all damaging. That is why even if it is an abnormal child, it is still healthy to deliver that child. Even if it is going to be a cost of 50-50 chance for the mother, it's still best to deliver that child. You understand? So, kayo at ako, you will have to ask these people, prove to me now. Ganyan dapat tayo, hindi tayo yung defensive. Tayo yung may material eh. Right? We're the ones who have the documents, materials, evidence. So our position should be proved to me today if abortion is at any one time beneficial. Alright? Because there's no benefit. And here, we can talk to them the whole day and I'll talk to them for you because there's none. And here are all of these. Maturity, the post-abortion syndrome woman never matures. She's stunted in her growth, no? Especially if she's not helped. All right, that's the woman. But in all abortions, there are men, correct? Yes. And the men are as damaged as all the women are. Ano po? Gwapo, no? Ha? Badik ba? No, this is... San ba yan galing? Ah, there you go. Alright, any questions so far about the women first before I go with the men? Any questions? Pakisulat, ha? If you have questions, we'll have open forum later. Alright, now about the men. Di ba sasabihin nila, out with every pregnancy, there's always a man. And in most countries, men have no legal right to stop an abortion. This is more in the Northern America, and where the legalized ang abortion. Ibig sabihin, pagka kahit na ang lalaki magpi-plead sa babae, please keep the baby, and the mother will say, "You have no right. This is my body." Ha? Magdusa ka dyan. But I'm going to the abortion clinic tomorrow. So there are countries that, and if this man goes to court, sasabihin niya sa judge, "I want my girlfriend to stop an abortion." What will the judge say? "You have no right. Lalaki ka, wala kang karapatan." See how emasculated in a way the men are. So the fathers of aborted children are kept from asserting their prerogative of territoriality and protection. Yan ang design ng Diyos eh. Di ba? Ipoprotect ang young, ipoprotect ang mother. Eh hindi na nawarak yung. Kaya galit na galit yung mga yan. Alright, post-abortion men's rage. Let's talk about their rage. Their rage stems from the shame. The shame of their masculine sexuality from the fact that sex resulted in the death of a baby. And usually the mothers will shame this man. Parang yeah! Mga telenovela. Isn't it? Well, especially in the legalized abortion countries. So, napakalaking factor nun. But no matter how courageous na men are, they feel very helpless because they cannot do anything when the mother decides to abort. They're young. Alright. Where am I? Rage at not being allowed to protect their baby and not being allowed to produce a child in their image. Now, this is interesting because, di ba, gentlemen, part of your design is that you would like to have a son or an image of your, you know, begotten son or begotten daughter. So pagka nasira yan, talo, ang galit na galit. They feel a deep anger at their partner who denied them fatherhood. They feel deprived of their manhood. No? All these are just what I'm discussing are where this rage comes from. All right. So they feel impotent and helpless from keeping this baby alive. Their rage is displaced onto other females. Now this is very interesting. Itong rage nila sa woman na to, now they will have to find somewhere else to place their rage. And the number two syndrome of post-abortion men are, they will go and look for another woman to impregnate. Sa mambababae yan, iiwan yan, mag-a-abort na mag-a-abort. O, di kaya nga ganito ang society natin, di ba? So, as a result of the father's inability to protect his young, there is deep underlying rage. But that is manifested in the rage toward more women. Huh? I hope you're seeing that. Okay. The rage together with his feelings of helplessness. Oops. Ha ha ha. Okay, after 3 years. Yan. Rage, together with his feelings of helplessness, expresses itself in increasing rates of rape, marital violence, impotence, and abandoning his family. Eh, hindi ba yan ang how we will describe our society now? Isn't it not surprising to us that in this... Now, please don't be naive. It's not only in the squatter areas that you find major marital violence. The upper bracket of society, ang mga mayayaman, they just go to New York. They go to Thailand. The C and D go and magpapahilot the midwives or sa Quiapo. But this one spans all the levels of society. So, hindi lang mahihirap ang nabubugbog. I have had many counselees na napakayayamang mga Chinese, mga hindi Chinese, no? Galit! Galit ang mga asawa. Bakit? Dahil nag-abort. Now, di ba sa China, kung ikaw ay nabuhay sa China, ikaw ay post-abortion survivor. Dahil lahat ng tao sa China dapat mag-abort. Eh kung ikaw ay nabuhay sa China, I'll explain later, that you are automatically a post-abortion survivor if you live in countries where there's a very high percentage of abortion. Tapos na ba ako? Why is it not moving? Ay, mali. Yeah. Well, another syndrome is distrust. Just much like the female, they distrust women naman. So talagang nakita niyo yung distortion. In a society where God designed for a woman to trust her man, and a man to live for another, for a woman, here, it destroys all that and creates distrust, which result in inability or disinclination to commit to their partner, which increases promiscuity. Okay, bago ako pumunta doon, ano ba yun? Kuya. I just want to make kwento about this one, about the disinclination to commit to their partner. There was one time we had a conference in Denmark, and we were interviewed in a radio program about post-abortion syndrome on men. Now I was quite interested why this woman is so interested in the dynamics for the men. So nagkwentuhan kami. It was about an hour and a half interview. So we shared to her all the dynamics of post-abortion syndrome. After the interview, sabi nung announcer sa akin, matandang babae, she told us, the two of us, sabi niya, this is the only time I understood why my husband was like that. Because daw, she married this man na who have had some abortions with other women, but she married him. And this man never bonded with her, nor her children. So wala daw relationship yung asawa niya sa kanya. Eventually, nag-divorce sila. Now, one of the interesting dynamics of abortion is that there is no connection that he will do with the wife now, nor the children now. Okay, I'll talk to that about that later more. About the grieving and the loss, abortion is not only a woman's issue, di ba? The men have to grieve also. But unfortunately, they're not allowed to. Nor do they talk about it. Eh, ang mga women nga, don't talk na nga about it. Lalo pa ang men, right? Mga mommies. The death of the unborn is not a real death, they say. They neglect their own healing to console the woman rather than express their own feelings of anger, hurt, and betrayal. Other words, the men have no words. Part of the grieving has to be put to words what you are feeling. Eh wala, they can't do that. Lalo na sa culture natin na tahimik yung lalaki, di lalo nang tatahimik. Kaya they're passively quiet, angry men. Scary man pagka naging na-trigger ng anger later on. They tend not to attach themselves emotionally to their preborn babies. And they do not support the mother, the present mother. Ito nga yung sinasabi ko sa inyo na dynamics nung taong yon. They will not attach themselves to their succeeding wife. They will not attach themselves to their children with other women. Wala. Kaya sabi ko sa inyo, cycle yan. The more abused, the more neglected, the more abused they are prone to, no? The more neglected and abused they are, the more they abort. After they abort, they will neglect their children. Kaya yung mga post-abortion women, iniiwan lang nila, they don't want to breastfeed. Ayaw nilang hawakan ang mga anak nila. I met a lady in Canada, and she told me her story that after two abortions, when she gave birth to the child whom she decided to live, she did not look at her for 2 months. She left her in the hospital. After 2 months, binalikan niya yung bata, kinuha niya. And thus, her whole struggle with this child, in post-abortion child. So we see here a vicious cycle again. They do not support the mother. When they do not support the mother, there's more abortions and miscarriage. More abortions and miscarriage, the more they are unattached to the preborn. So paikot-ikot yan, abort and ano, no? Alright. The dehumanization was so easy for the abortion that it becomes easier in attacking others. Rape results from a combination of helplessness, rage, and a desire to impregnate. Sa mga lalaki to, no? Of course, and then I'll just run through this. The fear of failure are more pronounced, no? Di ba ang dynamics ng men? Marami na tayong fears, the men, no? The more pronounced pa yon. They feel being judged. They fear making more decisions. They're fearing making risks. Kaya, all the more, there are more men who are just passive. Bahala kayo dyan. I don't know. This is mostly seen in Filipino men, right? I will dare say. Don't attack me. But, di ba, they always say this in some descriptions of our society, that the men allow their wives to take the charge in a matriarchal society. So you can just imagine the pronouncement of that, kung nag-abort pa sila. That's hundredfold pa. They will not move na. They will not take risk. Bahala ka sa buhay mo. Mamatay ka, mamatay ka. So nandiyan sila passive, passive, aggressive, passive-aggressive, if I may. There's a feeling of defeat, feeling unworthy, depression, and shame. Panic attacks, addictions. These addictions, of course, many of the post-abortion men go into substance abuse just to numb their feelings of failures or numb their anger. Substance meaning drug, alcohol mostly, yeah? Suicidal thoughts, sexual dysfunctions. Alright? So, yun mostly are the dynamics for the men. Now, I just wanted to share this kasi in Hope Alive, we've identified the 4 major factors why women abort. And number one, we found out in many of our surveys, number one is the lack of partner support. There are many women who say, if only my partner would have said like this, maybe she would not have aborted. The second factor is the young age. You know that. The third is the marital status. In our country, because of our OFW, Overseas Filipino Workers, so many of these overseas Filipino workers are separated from their spouses, right? So in Abu Dhabi, where they are, or wherever they are, they fall in love. Now, they cannot come home and be pregnant. That is why I found out recently that one of the highest abortion rates are among OFWs. Kailangan nating ipag-pray yun. Di ba? It makes sense? Kasi na-inlove sila doon. Nagkaroon ng relasyon. Paano sila uuwi? Na may anak. So kailangan i-abort nila doon. Para pag-uwi, walang anak. But the damage is major. Right? And then, this is what I wanted to point out. At least for the evangelical community, I feel I appreciate you, my Catholic brethren, because you're out there. And I feel I speak for myself, the evangelical community are too passive. We don't speak up like you. And that's why I go to all these pastors and say, speak up some more. Speak up about the RH bill. And that's why I appreciate Lily always inviting me to things like this, because I want to be a part of that. I always will quote my mentor. He said, we can never be passive observers. If we don't do anything, we are part of the problem. If we don't do anything against abortion, we are causing abortion to happen. So I don't want to be a part of that. I want to be a part of educating people about the damages. I want to be a part of making sure there's help and healing available for them. All right, what else? Many women who have had abortions report that they were waiting for their boyfriends to stop them. Isn't it interesting? I know that Dr. Ney would stand up. There are times he would stand up. Yung mga lifeline, they have this, no? But they have a restraining order that you should not be any... How far is that from the abortion clinic? How far should you be, the restraining order? 60 feet? In their country, meron silang order by law. You cannot... Di ba, sa kanila may mga abortion clinics talaga. And by law, if you are against abortion, you cannot go anywhere 60 feet from that clinic. Because you're not allowed to stop. And I have good friends who were imprisoned, and they will continue to want to be imprisoned because they made a stand to help stop. One time daw, my mentor saw a man standing in front of the abortion clinic, obviously distressed. And he came close to this man and discussed, are you okay? What's going on? Do you have a girlfriend there? And he said, yes, I have a girlfriend in front in the clinic, and I don't want her. I don't know what to do. So Dr. Ney talked to the men. Now this is interesting because you always consider just the women. You have to consider the men, the partners of these people. So this man, he talked to him, and then he just discussed and nudged him and say, go inside. Tell her you will take care of the baby. Get her out of there. And that gave the man courage. And he did. He went. And then got the girl. Kasi nandun na sa clinic. So that was one thing we rejoiced about at that time. So there are opportunities like that that kailangan yung mga men. I would have calls from some men here in Manila. Obviously distressed because they don't know what to do. Their girlfriends would get their abortions in Thailand. Wala na, nakalipad na. Anong gagawin mo nga naman? Alright? So, but, you know, if the boyfriend at any one time will just say, no, I will walk with you through this, this pregnancy. Let's keep the baby. Ay, nako. All right. Q&A time. All right. Questions, answers, questions. You have questions? No questions? Okay. What? Yes.
I'm just curious. You have mentioned that your evangelical brothers or and sisters, they are passive to this. May I know what's the official position of the evangelicals? And then those bishops in the television, they call themselves bishops, who wore red, I think, pink. Are they evangelicals? What denominations are they? Thank you.
This breaks my heart. But unfortunately, there's a bishop in the evangelical community who endorses R.H. Bill. And there, we have had a forum. I asked for an audience with him. So it was me, him, and the lawyer Winnie Salimbides, who was in the forum. And I presented to him everything about the RH bill that is wrong. And he listened. At the end of the conversation, kasi forum hindi naman po debate eh. And I didn't want to debate. I was just showing him factually what is not right. Unfortunately, he thinks because there are good points talaga naman, di ba? Yung RHB, taking care of the wife, of the baby, the mother. He's bringing that forth more to approve it. And he probably does not want to look at the other parts. So I told him right there in front of him, Pastor, kung ako po ba ay may puprove ko sa inyo na ino po ay hindi tama, are you willing to change your mind? Oo naman daw. So, so you can pray because he is quite influential in the evangelical community. Although, that's what I am trying to help see. I've sought an audience with many of the pastors. Kasi po, Lily knows this, I have sent the RH bill to my mentor, Dr. Ney. Sabi ko, Dr. Ney, can you help me nga? Can you make him my, what's wrong with this bill? So, have you given them to this to him? You need to ask this from Lily because he, by line, he hinimay-may niya talaga yan. And you have to give, we need to give you this. You need to know what is wrong with this RH bill. You cannot just say this dahil sinabi nito. No, you have to know this scientifically why it is wrong. So that was what we were presenting to him. At the end of the forum, he asked us to be a part of a team that will put to words what we will present to Malacañang. Sabi, open naman siya, with due respect to this man, he's not an evil man. He's just so ignorant. He's ignorant about stuff. And maybe he's not wanting to know. Maybe he doesn't want a mess. I don't know. But unfortunately po, meron pong maraming ganun. It breaks my heart. Kaya ako po ay kinakausap ko yung mga pastor. Pastor! Mga ganyan. So it's quite an interesting challenge. But even if kayo rin po, hindi rin dapat you, I'm sorry, I challenge all of you too. Not because this leader in your congregation says he's not for RH Bill. You should know why you're not for RH Bill. That's why you need to understand. Pagtanongin ko kayo ngayon, bakit kayo against the RH Bill? Alam niyo kung bakit? Buti na lang. All right. Hallelujah. I'm glad that's true. But yes, there are some, not all. Many are against the RH bill. Yes, yes, oo naman po. Kaya lang, napopronounce this man kasi nasa TV siya. And he has media mileage. So there are a lot of evangelicals who understand it, and we're helping them understand it. We have presented all these documents to some of the senators. I'm working with Sister Pilar on this. So, yun. So you can pray for that part of the evangelical community. Yes.
Good afternoon po. Thank you for a very insightful presentation. I just have a few questions. First is, I would like to clarify, kasi diba we're talking about post-abortion syndrome. So with that regard po, with the term, is it any person or any woman who used abortifacient or in any point of, if that is so, will the PAS be something like, if may PAS ba kung aware yung person, like sa men, if they're aware that there's an abortion happened or the woman has used an abortifacient, then PAS will happen, and if not, there will be no PAS. And third is, with your experience po, has the gravity of the grief or the gravity of PAS parang mas grieve ba pag depending on the method that is used? And with your experience, yun lang po.
Good questions. Ano may una?
with the PAS po ba yung tawag basta any person has been using or used abortifacient?
Right. An answer to that question is yes. Any person, balik ka dito. Any person who has taken an abortifacient, kahit yung mga herbal, and they were pregnant, and nalaglag, any form po. Don't be naive. In Africa, they use bamboo sticks. In the provinces, they use hangers. So, what do you do? And especially as Obama is here now, wala nang partial birth, kahit na anong, wala nang 4 months. Di ba dati 4 months, hindi pa baby. Ngayon, kahit na 9 months, hindi pa baby hanggat wala sa labas. So, dahil sa partial birth of partial... Second question is,
kung add on.
Yes.
Kasi 'di ba abortifacient din po yung mga pills, kasi you're taking it like,
yes,
before.
Yes.
Okay.
In my experience, there are women who actually felt that they were supposed to have one child and they were taking a pill. We have an exercise in Hope Alive that we envision how many children we should have had. And it's interesting that they welcome in their minds, dapat, kasi ang anak lang nila, dalawa. Lalabas sa vision nila, 4 or 4. Dahil, 4 or 5. English ko lang. So, it's not surprising that they will see it in when they really want to face the truth. God is a God of truth. And when we're willing to face the truth, He will expose the truth. And He does that to many women. That lady I was telling you about, I only told you that she has had 8. When she did Hope Alive, she realized that she has had 13. Because of the... She remembered that she did this, and she would remember the feeling of being pregnant. Later on, when I talk to you about post-abortion survivor syndrome, you know, it's a design of God. I've never been pregnant, I'm single, but I know that many women say that when they're pregnant, they actually feel the time that the male sperm meets the egg, maybe. because it's the DNA, you know, the Spirit of God is in there. So, alam po nila. Ano yung pangatlo mo?
Yung second question ka po, yung about PAS, will it happen just pag you're just aware of the abortion or even if you're not aware?
Ah, no! Even if, I'll explain to you later, many of the children who has had parents nila nag-abort, they know that they should have had an elder sibling. So, tama ba yung sagot ko sa'yo? Ah, okay. Her question is more, if I'm a man and I didn't know she was pregnant, will I know? Ganun ba? Ah, okay. Will I have the symptoms? Yes. Unfortunately, yes. I've had counselors who are like that. Again, no? When I say syndrome, it means a set of symptoms. It's not all the time everybody has. Ha? So merong wala. Merong meron. Ha? I want that clear. So there have been some families who I've worked with that there's a post-abortion woman na hindi naman niya na-experience daw yon. Pero in the back of my mind, maybe hindi pa niya ina-accept. I don't know. I don't know what's going on. So, ano yung pangatlo?
With your experience, is the gravity of PAS depends on the method they used?
No. Unfortunately, no. Kahit na anong method yan, maybe, let me backtrack a little bit. That's true. You're right. Her question is, does it matter what form of abortion, and will it impact you in a different way if it were partial abortion or if it were the morning pill, morning after pill? I only speak for myself. I don't know. With some of the women that I've worked with, I think mas overt ang PAS syndrome sa mga 2 month, 3 month old na nag-abortion kaysa sa morning after pills or pills lang. Mas overt yung signs dun sa later stage of pregnancy.
Okay, thank you very much.